Yeah, so the less morbid procedure, alternative, less morbid alternative surgery, radiation. So I'll be going over the basic principle of it and ideal patient for focal therapy, the current guideline, outcomes, and then future directions. As you, as previously mentioned, Matt and others have mentioned that prostate cancer is a spectrum of disease, and it ranges from low to very high risk cancer. And UCSF, we believe that the treatment should match the extent of the disease and the patient. So focal therapy has a space in this spectrum, particularly between low and intermediate risk disease. I think in the future, we may offer to in the case of relapse and metastatic setting. Now, improvement in cancer localization and risk assessment have resulted in a more wider adoption of focal therapy across the United States. Focal therapy has been around for 20 years, but because of our inability to target these areas accurately, that's why it hasn't been widely adopted. But now it is more common because of the advanced technology. So focal therapy is treating a section or a focus area of the prostate to minimize the side effects. So often, as you know, treating the whole gland has issue with urinary function and sexual function, whereas treating a focus area or section of the prostate, then you maintain your sexual function, including ejaculatory volume. You maintain your urination function as well. So that could be very attractive to men in a certain risk spectrum. So the whole premise of our focal therapy is that if we target the dominant tumor, the problem tumor, that we can really minimize the side effects. So this is a paper published many years ago looking at lineage tracing of a cancer that has spread throughout the body. So looking at the copy number analysis of genes throughout the metastasis, they can actually trace it back to one clone in a prostate. Now, prostate cancer, 70% or higher of those men will have multifocal disease, but the dominant tumor may be the responsible one. So if we can accurately identify the clone or the metastatic clone within that prostate and target it precisely, then we don't have to treat the whole gland and prevent metastases and death. So that's the whole premise. And research at UCSF, led by Dr. Carroll, have also shine a little bit more light on this. This is a study of over 1,000 men on active surveillance, and most of these men have multiple biopsies throughout. So you can see here, most of the progression occur in the area of the dominant tumor. So if they are a candidate for focal ablation at the first biopsy, they remain so even after four or five biopsies as we survey their cancer throughout the 5 years or 10 years period. So who are the ideal candidate for focal therapy? It has to be localized intermediate risk cancer. Those are the patients with Gleason 7 cancer. And also in carefully selected Gleason 6 cancer, or sometimes unfavorable intermediate disease. Now, the tumor location is important. It has to be away from the urethra and the rectum. And also the patients have to agree to lifelong surveillance. So I often tell the patient, this is not a cure, it's to ablate the main dominant tumor. So they have to still go on surveillance after. So there's multiple ways we can ablate the tumor. There's a focal, and we can target the quadrant, or sometimes hemiablation, we'll ablate half of the prostate, or we can use a hockey stick approach if these are the location of the tumor. And the patient selection, so most of the patients that I offer this to must have an MI fusion biopsy to make sure we don't miss any other cancer. Sometimes I order a PSMA PET scan for staging. The tumor location is often how we pick the certain type of energy to ablate the cancer. And also, I require all patients to have a rectal exam and an ultrasound exam to see if they have calcification, for instance, in the prostate, this would interfere with ultrasound. You know, the calcification will deflect off the sound. So those and rectal stenosis, that kind of thing, we going through the rectum. So those are the selection of the patient. Now, how do we do it? There's multiple ways we use different energy sources to target the cancer. One is argon gas to freeze it. You can use brachytherapy or the radiation seed to put it in there. And also transrectally, we can use ultrasound to ablate the cancer. So it depends on the location. If you have an anterior tumor, typically I would favor focal cryotherapy. Posterior tumor near the rectum, then ultrasound would be a better approach to reach that tumor. So there's now laser that we can use, laser right into the tumor and apply heat there. And there's also focal irreversible electroporation. This is using electrode to put around the tumor and deliver electric shock through it to destroy the tumor. Focal therapy, focal brachytherapy, cryotherapy, and also using TULSA. This is to apply ultrasound through the urethra. So in cases where patient has a large median lobe or a lot of symptom from benign enlargement, we can use that to tackle the transition zone also. So for focal therapy at UCSF, we focus on ultrasound and cryotherapy. Cryotherapy has been around for many years now. We recently started a HIFU program last year. And this is done through the robotic approach where your patient have to go under general anesthetic. We would use an MRI to guide ablation. So we target using the MRI and the ultrasound, and then we plan for the planning. The whole thing takes about an hour or so. So the focus ultrasound really apply heat to the tissue. Each of the sections is about 1.7 millimeter each time we ablate them. And you can see there's a steep drop up in temperature around it. So that way we can minimize the effect around it. So this is an actual ablation planning that I've done. This is a fusion of a MRI with the ultrasound. So you can see the tumor right into the 3D image here. Here's a tumor, here's a plan. Typically I would ablate about 7 to 5 millimeter beyond the tumor to get an adequate margin. And this is actual ablation that's going on. So this is what the tissue looks like. 24 hours later, the tissue is heated up to 85 to 95 degrees Celsius and it is destroyed by a necrosis. 3 months later, you'll be that tissue is replaced by fibrous tissue. So the current guidelines, so the NCCN guideline stated that HIFU cryotherapy is an option for radio recurrent prostate cancer, but they have not recommended it as a primary therapy yet for localized disease. The AUA guideline, based on expert opinion, mentioned that focal ablation may be considered in selected patient, an appropriately informed patient, and we should inform the patient that there's lack of high quality data comparing the outcome with surgery or radiation. EUA guideline said the HIFU cryotherapy is to be used only in a clinical trial setting. The German guidelines approve it for low risk, but not for higher risk cancer. Now, there's several ways that focal therapy can fail. So this is the slide I often show patients when I counsel them. When we offer this to them. So how can focal therapy fail? So one is inadequate heat to a tumor. So a tumor that you have recurrent within the area of treatment. And then inadequate margin, we try to ablate 5 to 7 millimeter outside of the tumor, but there's more extension beyond that, we will have residual disease in the area where we treat. And then there's this field effect where other part of the prostate that is not treated, you can have new cancer or you have a progression of a six, at least in six to at least in seven, And then inadequate staging, if a patient have metastatic disease or at the time of diagnosis and we don't know about it and we were off for this, then we would miss the chance of adequately treat that patient. So at UCSF, focal therapy has been around for many years, led by Dr. Shinohara. This is outcome of 95 patients I have done over the years, and with this median follow-up for failure-free survival was 96 at 2 years follow-up. Three patients has metastases. Now, the three patients that has metastases, when they re-biopsy, there's no cancer to the prostate, but the patient had metastases. This is because the patient presented with metastases in the first place, I think. And one patient has a salvage prostatectomy 5 and then went radiation. There's a slight decline in their sexual function over time. There's no changes in their urinary function. So this is another study in the United States, published recently in Lancet Oncology, showing focal therapy using MI guided of 100 men. You can see a 24-month follow-up, 88% has no recurrent cancer that is significant. Now, in terms of functional outcome in that study, there is a slight decrease in erection from 100 to 90% over the study period. There's no patient with stress urinary incontinence require use of PAD. Only one patient has a grade 3 adverse event, that is a urinary tract infection. One patient had a stricture that resolved with a single dilation. Now, if you look at a long-term follow-up, this is 500 patients, 600 patients with 5 years follow-up. At 5 years, 88% has no recurrent, and 98% has no metastases. 100% is still alive after focal ablation. 2% has urinary incontinence that required the use of one PAD. Bowel complication was rare, only 0.3%. If you look at a longer follow-up, this is a 15 years follow-up in Europe of more than 1,000 men. 132 men underwent salvage out of 1,000 men. 132 men undergo salvage whole gland systematic treatment. Three patients developed metastases, one of whom died from prostate cancer. A 7 years follow-up, 68% has no recurrent, for the high risk, for intermediate risk and high risk patient, at 7 years, 65% has no risk of recurrent. And no one died from the cancer at 7 years, and no one has metastases. So the oncologic outcome is very promising at longer term follow-up. Now this is a 20 years follow-up, 21 year follow-up after 674 patients undergoing whole gland ablation. As you see here, patient who had low or intermediate risk disease who opted for focal HIFU. If you look here, cancer specific survival is very good at 95% and 89% at 21 years follow up. For high risk disease, it's 65%. So we don't favor this approach for high risk disease patients. So I think for future, new research is needed to improve the recurrent rate. Currently at 5 years, 20% recurrent rate, I think is too high. I think we need to do more research to improve that. And I think using advanced technology will improve it in terms of selecting the appropriate patient for it. The use of genomic and PSMA PET, I think in the future will be used more widely to better select patient for this. And the use of MRI, PSMA PET to guide ablation. I think this will be the future here. The also adjuvant and new adjuvant setting, the role of immunotherapy with a combination of focal therapy. I think that could be an area of research in the future. So what about an active surveillance? You've heard a lot about patients with active surveillance. So focal therapy could be an option for the patient who do not have access to active surveillance, or want to decrease the cost and the mobility of repeated biopsies and PSA check every 3 months and so on. So it could be, we may be offering this to select the patient with low risk disease or patient who has germline mutations, so high risk, high grade or adverse pathology. and so or at the time of progression. I'll give you an example of how we use the latest technology to help decrease risk of recurrence. So this is a patient who has is a 78-year-old gentleman who diagnosed with Gleason 7 cancer, 4-3 PSA of 11. So on the MRI, there's two areas. There's a pyrite 5 here at the base, anterior base, and there's a pyrite 4 at the left base. Now, this was biopsy. This area turned out to be negative for cancer. Here is a PSMA PET scan showing at the base, the area there, there's no cancer there. Now, there is a cancer here that is detected. This is 4+3. You can see here is the left side, left mid gland. So we offer focal therapy for this patient because it is looks like this cancer is only detected only on the left apex, left mid, so left base. So we would ablate the whole left gland. However, I got a PET scan, a PSMA PET scan prior to the ablation. And you can see this is, there's the additional foci cancer at the anterior apex. This will be too close to the urethra. Imagine if I take this patient and ablate half of his prostate, you still have residual disease here. So this patient, I told him, you know, we would not be an ideal candidate because of this PSMA PET that showed a cancer at the apex that was not visible on the MRI or the ultrasound. Now, in the past, we would take this patient to get focal therapy, we would have a recurrence. So that's how we use PET imaging. Here's a patient we have detected a lymph node metastasis for Gleason 7, rare, but it can happen. This is another patient who had additional foci of cancer that was not detected on biopsy. So these are ways that at UCSF that we've been using. And also, we're also using these genetic markers to select our patient. Patient who has higher genomic risk that is in the high risk group, I don't offer a focal therapy to. So for the take home message, I think focal therapy fills an existing gap between active surveillance and whole gland therapy, surgery, radiation. And it is associated with minimal side effects. Study after study have shown this. Up to 80%, 90% of the patient maintain the sexual function after. Stress and content is extremely low. There is promising oncologic data after 15 and 20 years follow up. And new research is needed to reduce recurrent risk. And ultimately, the success of focal therapy depends on the patient selection. Lifelong surveillance, the patient has to agree to. And also, we need to use high quality MRIs and targeted biopsy, and perhaps the use of genomic and PSMA PET to select this patient for this therapy. So I'd like to end with an acknowledgement for Dr. Carroll. He's the one that told me to revamp our focal therapy program 2 years ago, and now you refer a lot of patients to us for focal therapy. We've done over the last year, 100 patients now, and Dr. Shinohara has been the champion of focal therapy for many, many years. Dr. Kasudo is the one that got us the HIFU machine and the rest of my colleagues in the department. Thank you.